So the way a robot acts, so there is a reward and penalty concept. So for the correct action, a reward is associated, right? Your reward is given, and for the wrong action, a penalty is given. So it takes a best optimized solution and tries to maximize the rewards. So it is about taking suitable action to maximize the reward in a particular situation. It is employed by various software and machines to find the best possible behavior or path it should take in a specific situation. So it is primarily maximizing your rewards. So it is both the reward and penalty concept for any action in an environment, but reinforcement learning is primarily for optimizing and maximizing your rewards. So if you see that these are some of the cases which AI has been successful in last so many years. So one example, you would see that Deep Blue defeated the reigning world chess champion Garry Kasparov in 1997. So Deep Blue was a AI-driven machine learning algorithm. Then AI proved a mathematical conjecture unsolved for decades. So it was able to solve one of the mathematical conjecture. No hands across America, 98% of the time from. So driving autonomous vehicle from Pittsburgh to San Diego, 98% of the time it was all driven autonomously. Again, a great success, right? During the 91 Gulf War, US forces deployed an AI logistic planning and scheduling program that involved up to 50,000 vehicles, cargo, and people. So to optimize the logistic planning and scheduling program, so they have used the AI application. Even the NASA's onboard autonomous planning program controlled the scheduling of operations of a spacecraft. So they are also using AI to the fullest. And another application called Proverb, it solves the crossword puzzle better than any of the most of the humans. So we have seen that various uses of AI and how successful they have been. So when we see what are the various types of machine learning, we would classify them into supervised learning, unsupervised learning, or reinforced learning, which is decision-making learning. In the supervised learning, we have this regression, decision trees, and K classification techniques. In unsupervised learning, the clustering algorithm and the association rules, they can be as part of the unsupervised learning. And we would be learning Markovian decision process in the reinforced learning. So we can all cluster them into the supervised, unsupervised, and reinforced learning. So, but there is also a concept of semi-supervised. So I'll talk about semi-supervised, which means that it's a combination of supervised, and when after certain information has been supervised, then you run the unsupervised learning to make a combination of make it a super semi-supervised learning. In supervised, we said classification and regression techniques are there. In classification, we assign each input vector to one of the finite number of discrete categories. And in a regression, the output consists of one of or more continuous variables. Based on certain x, you are able to predict the y value. So, and in unsupervised learning, like clustering, estimation, and visualization, they are all using unsupervised learning. And in clustering, let's say, discover groups of similar examples. So we are clustering groups according to various patterns of the data. Density estimation determine the distribution of data within the given input space. Similarly, in semi-supervised, I'm sure you would have seen that Google gives you an alert that these photographs are all clubbed together. Can you name them? So it is asking you to name that particular photo. And if you say a particular name to that group of photographs, next time it automatically assigns that name to that kind of a photograph. That means it has become, you have made it learn that these groups of photographs are grouped under, let's say, your friend's name. And next time when that friend's name or image is uploaded, it automatically captures that image against that particular name. So it has categorized all those against a, so it becomes a semi-supervised kind of a learning. And reinforced learning, we are going to discuss more details about it. So just to give you an example of supervised learning, so supervised learning is a machine learning group in which we teach or train the machine using data which is well labeled. That means one data is already tagged with the correct answer, right? After that, the machine is provided with new sets of data so that the supervised learning algorithm analyzes the training data, the new data, and produces a correct output from the labeled data. So you have already defined this as apple or orange or a banana from a set of fruits. So let's take an example where we are given a basket filled with different kinds of fruits, right? And now the first step is to train the machine with all the different fruits one by one. So you have to define the characteristics of that fruit. So if the shape of the object is round and depression at the top having color red, then it will be labeled as an apple, right? Similarly, if a shape is of the object is a long curving cylindrical having color green, yellow, then it is labeled as banana. So you have given them a name and defined the characteristics. So now suppose after training the data, you are given a new separate fruit, let's say banana, from the basket and asked to identify it. So system now knows that it will first identify the characteristics of that. So since the machine has already learned the things from the previous data, it will first classify the group with its shape and color. So it is trying to classify the characteristics of the fruit and would confirm the fruit named as the banana and put it in the banana category. So that's how the supervised learning is all about. So you are training the data with respect to providing certain inputs, and then on a training data, it is able to classify according to the given inputs. Some of the examples we said was regression, logistic regression, classification, naive Bayesian classifier, decision tree, support vector machines. So these are some of the algorithms which are used in supervised learning. So advantages of supervised learning are, like, supervised learning allows the collecting of data and producing the data output from the previous experience. So you are giving that input to the system from the your previous experience. It helps to optimize the performance criteria with the help of the experience, and supervised machine learning helps to solve the various types of real world computation problem. So some of the disadvantages of supervised learning: classifying big data can be a challenge if you are collecting one data at a time and all doing classifying. But when you have a big data concept, millions and billions of records you have to compute, so then it becomes a challenging activity. Training for supervised learning need a lot of computation time, so it requires a lot of time. So this is a supervised learning. Next comes this unsupervised learning. So unsupervised learning is the training of machines using information that is neither classified nor labeled, and allowing the algorithm to act on that information without any guidance. Here the task of machine is to group unsorted information according to certain similarities, the patterns and their differences without any prior training data. So it will classify those objects according to the different specifications and group it in different categories. So for instance, suppose it is given an image having both dogs and cats which have never seen by the algorithm. Machine has no idea about the features of these dogs and cats, so we can't categorize it as dog or a cat, but it can categorize them according to the similarities or patterns and their differences, right? So based on those characteristics, similarities and differences, it is able to identify them all as dogs or all as cats. So it doesn't know whether these are dogs or cats, but it has grouped them according to their characteristics. So it allows the model to work on its own to discover these patterns and information that was previously undetected. It mainly deals with unlabeled data. And I, as I said, semi-supervised is primarily when it has a group of data, it has classified them into dogs and cats. Now, with your knowledge, you can classify them as dog and cat. So the next algorithm, when it picks up the data, it knows that these are dogs. So it will identify the next animal as dog or a cat, right? So that becomes the semi-supervised learning. So in unsupervised learning, classified into two categories of algorithm, clustering and association. The clustering problem is where you want to discover the inherent groupings in the data, such as grouping customers by purchasing behavior or their knowledge behavior understanding, or your age grouping can be, they can be clustered based on different age groups or whatever, right? So that is clustering. Association rule, learning from a problem that you want to discover rules that describe large portion of your data, such as people that buy X also tend to buy Y. So in the market basket concept, you would have seen that the shelf management is done based on the buying pattern of the consumers. So if they are likely to buy, if they are going likely to buy X, they are also like tend to buy Y also. If that is the data, then they can be placed together, right? So the next customer will tend to buy Y because the data says so. And maybe the next month the data may be different. So market basket concept is shuffling their shelves according to the buying behavior of their customers. So these are some of the major data mining algorithms. So classification, which is predicting an item class. Clustering, finding the clusters in the data. Association rule, where when you are buying A and B, you are likely to purchase C, so which occurs frequently. And visualization, which is more of a histogram, bar chart, and different, so you can visualize the data in different formats, word cloud and all. Summarizing is describing a group of data with respect to mean, median, mode, right? Or box plotting and all that can be done using summarization rules. Deviation detection is finding the outliers. So outliers in the sense that a customer continuously buys from his credit card a value of 5,000, 10,000 range, right? And all of a sudden, if 1 lakh transaction is done through a credit card, the credit card company will immediately get an alert, right? So which means that 1 lakh transaction has happened, and they'll try to find out from the customer whether it was you who has done the transaction for 1 lakh rupees. If a customer is already doing a transaction of 1 lakh rupees and all of a sudden 10 lakh worth of a transaction happens, so it is based on the continuous behavior, and then there is an outlier. So outlier is used in so many applications. Then estimation. So regression is one of them. So based on the current trend of the sales, we predict the month year end sales, next month sale, right? So that way estimation is done. Link analysis, finding the relationship between various entities. So broadly they can be clubbed into these four groups: clustering, association rule, anomaly detection, and the predictive models. So clustering, you will see a lot of data based on different clusters of different behavior and patterns of the data. Association rule, I said, if you are likely to purchase milk and Pampers, then you are most likely to purchase beer as well. So if that is the case, so the market basket will make the shelves accordingly. So milk and Pampers, and then you would find beer also next to that, because people tend to buy, when they are buying these two items, they tend to buy the beer also. So those are the association rules. Next is the predictive models. So based on the data, you are trying to cluster them into tree structure, so that whether a particular credit card worthiness has been, the person has to be assigned or given credit card or not, that can be done using various data that it shows. What kind of customers, what is the feature that those customers become delinquent, or they are not paying on time. So it characterizes those kind of customers, and it disapproves similar kind of, on the same kind of a data, it disapproves certain credit cards also. Anomaly detection we have already seen. So antiviruses or viruses, so they are an outlier. So in this continuous pattern of data, all of a sudden lot amount of data has been transferred or incoming. So the system understands that the inflow and outflow of the data was something different, but now all of a sudden the data has started, the volume of data is more, so it will block certain ports, or it will try to restrict certain applications which data. So that is what is antivirus concept. And you would have seen that all of a sudden you would have received certain messages that have you tried logging in from, let's say, Hong Kong or Singapore or some other country, which you are not there. So it has blocked that kind of a malicious login, and it has informed you how it does that. It knows that your IP address is in the range of these, right? So in Delhi, NCR area, or Lucknow area, or some other area, right? So based on that, it has identified that you are generally logging in from that area or from those IPs. But all of a sudden, if the country has changed, so that is treated as a outlier, and the system blocks that account or blocks that login attempt, and sends a mail to you saying that, have you tried logging from? If no, then ignore it, or else you can block that IP or something. Corrective action can be taken. Even the data mining can be grouped as predictive and descriptive analytics. So in descriptive, it is more of defining the historical data with respect to their clustering, their summarization, what has happened. So it is more historical data which you are trying to analyze. And predictive is like time series analysis, regression, classification, prediction. So it is more futuristic. You are trying to, based on the historical past, you have generated a model, and now you are predicting the future. So based on your sales pattern, it is trying to estimate your next month's sale or year end sale, right? Even in the time series, you would have seen the seasonal effect of the time series and all that, and finally it is able to estimate next month or next day's. Even weather forecasting uses this time series analysis. So this is a summary of all the algorithms. I've tried to club them into a single snapshot so that you get a better idea of what these deep learning algorithms are, ensemble, neural network, right? Regularization, rule-based learning systems, regression, clustering, right? Instance-based, okay, mean clustering and dendrogram, dimension reduction, right? So decision tree. So these are all supervised and unsupervised learnings. And now we'll focus on. So when we see, so this is a summary of what various machine learning algorithms are. So if we see the supervised learning, it is more classification and regression. And these are some of the use cases, diagnostics, right? Customer retention, image classification, identifying the fraud detection. So they are all part of this classification technique. In the supervised learning, regression, we can see advertising popularity prediction, weather forecasting, right, market forecasting, estimating the life expectancy, right, or population growth prediction. So these are all the regression techniques which uses the historical data, and it is estimating the future data. In unsupervised learning, it is clustering and dimension reduction. In the clustering, we have seen customer segmentation as in, so you have the CRM data, you can then cluster your data according to different patterns, and then you do a target marketing. You don't have to send messages to all kind of users. If a particular kind of a product is there and you're targeting a particular kind of a customer, you can cluster them and only send those messages to that kind of a customer. Target marketing, right? Recommender systems, they all use the clustering concept. And in dimension reduction, you can use big data visualization, meaningful compression, structure discovery, or feature elicitation. And in the reinforcement learning, which we are going to learn today, it could be a real-time decisions or even the robotic navigation, learning task, skill acquisition, or some AI gaming applications. So they all use reinforced learning. So that was about various types of machine learning algorithms. So reinforced learning differs from the supervised learning in not needing a labeled input output pairs to be presented, and in not needing the suboptimal actions to be explicitly corrected. Instead, the focus is on finding a balance between the exploration and exploitation, right? So exploration is of uncharted territory and exploitation is for the knowledge, the current knowledge. So it is a balance between exploration, so exploring the territory, and exploitation, your reward, your current knowledge. So the environment is typically stated in the form of a Markovian decision process, MDP. And because many reinforcement learning algorithms for this context use dynamic programming techniques. What is this dynamic programming? It is both a mathematical optimization method and a computer programming method. The method was developed by Richard Bellman in 1950. So it's a very old application or process or algorithm, and has found applications in numerous fields, from aerospace engineering to even the economics. So the main difference between the classical dynamic programming method and reinforcement learning algorithm is that the latter do not assume knowledge as of an exact mathematical model of the MDP, and they target large MDPs where exact method becomes infeasible. So dynamic programming and Markovian decision process. So one of the example I'll take is of a airline meal planning. So do you think the meal planning for airlines is easy? No, it is not, because these service providers who are providing the meal to different airlines, they have to plan according to multiple parameters, and it's not an easy job. So goal is to get the right number of meals for on each flight, right? So when it is an international flight or those flights, you tend to ask for anything out of the total menu, right? So why it is hard? Because meal preparation lead time is there, load uncertainty. So this flight may go half empty only. So it is unpredictable. Last minute uploading capacity constraints. So based on different passenger pattern, so your last minute uploading capacity constraints are there. So why it is so important to an airline? Like 500 flights per day, 365 days, and assume a $5 per meal. So this is a huge volume of money that has, so it has to be well optimized. So meal planning has to be very well done. So even the difference of optimization from 36 to 6 hours is very vague, you would see. And the difference of predicting a meal from 6 hours to 3 hours, to some extent it has optimized. Even from 3 to 2 is almost the same, but outliers at least have been reduced. 2 to 1 last minute, some outliers can happen. And when the difference is between 1 hour and zero at the time of flight, hardly any outliers are there, and the prediction levels are almost accurate. So the meal planning decision process is at several key decision points up to 3 hours before the departure. The meal planner observes reservations and the meals allocated and adjusts the allocated meal quantity accordingly. So just 3 hours before, so that they are able to adjust the meal quantity. Hourly, in the last 3 hours, the adjustments are made, but the cost of adjustment is slightly higher, right? So because the product would have come, whether it is waste or not, it will. So next flight is 4 hours now. So can this food wait for another 4 hours? No, it cannot. So similarly, they have to plan for the wastages as well. So significant higher and limited by delivery van capacity and the uploading logistics. So multiple factors, then it is a Markovian decision process which comes into play. So this is how you see that at different hours of the departure of the plane, you would have the adjustment van, delivery of the order. So it all changes according to different time, and the planning has to be done very efficiently. So the operational goal is to develop a meal planning strategy that minimizes the expected total overage, underage, or operational costs. All of a sudden, if the flight is heavily loaded, they were expecting 75%, now 100%. So you have to immediately ask for additional food, right? In such cases, the cost of that food increases. So the meal planning strategy specifies at each decision point the number of extra meals to prepare or deliver for any unobserved meal allocation and reservation quantity. So multiple factors make this a very complex process. So why is finding an optimal meal planning strategy very challenging? So at different points, decision points are there, right? Let's assume 108 passengers with 108 possible actions. So strategy requires these many order quantity, combination of different order quantities. And there are so many strategies to be considered because of number of flights. So considering this, the demand must be forecasted. So for this forecasting mechanism, the planning has to be done properly. A similar decision is made at several time points. There are costs associated with each decision point. Right, the decision has future consequences on the cost and performance of the company, and the overall cost depends on several events. So whether the flight has been overbooked now or underbooked, so that way the cost changes. So there is uncertainty about the future. So whenever there is an uncertainty about the future, you have to calculate the probability of those events happening, and then you have to use the Markovian decision process to best optimize your decisions. So what is Markovian decision process? It's a mathematical representation of a sequential decision making problem in which a system evolves around time, through time. So the system is evolving. The decision maker controls it by taking the action at a pre-specified point. So at certain points, it takes some actions, and actions incur immediate cost or accrue immediate reward and affect the subsequent system state. So it is a reward and penalty kind of a situation. At every step, it takes a decision whether it has been assigned an award, reward, or it has been penalized for some action. So accordingly, it takes a next action and it is trying to maximize its returns. So rewards have to be maximized. So that is what is the Markovian decision process. And when we talk about reinforced learning, so reinforcement learning is a type of machine learning. It allows machine and software agent to automatically determine the idle behavior within a specified context. So the context is clear, and in that it is trying to identify in order to maximize its performance. And the simple reward feedback is required for the agent to learn its behavior. So let's say when we are training a dog, right? So when we are training a dog, and if the dog does the correct action, you give them a treat, right? The dog now understands that this is the action that has to be done. And when it does a wrong activity or wrong action, and you give him a small beat, right? So now dog understands that I don't have to do this kind of an activity. So now it is learning by these rewards and penalties, and it is trying to, and that way you are trying to make the dog learn. So you are enforcing the learning process. So this is an example of a reinforced learning where you are training your dog. So there are many different algorithms that tackle this issue. As a matter of fact, reinforced learning is defined by a specific type of problem, and all of its solutions are classed as reinforced learning algorithm. In this problem, there is an agent. So the agent is supposed to decide the best action to select based on its current state. So it has a current state. The agent decides which action to take next. When this step is repeated, the problem is known as the Markovian decision process. So this MDP, Markovian decision process model, contains a set of possible world states. So we'll name it as S. The set of models, set of possible actions, A, right? Actions, and the real value reward function, reward, R, as a function of S and A. State and their action, based on the state and action, you define the various reward function and the policy of the solution of the Markovian decision process. So we'll be learning the S, A, and R of MDP. So why so interesting? If the transition probabilities are known, if you know the probabilities, it becomes a straightforward computational problem, right? If you know the probability of action happening, it is a mathematical model then. But if the transition probabilities are unknown, you have to calculate some probability, right? Then it is a problem of reinforced learning. So you're not doing a computational algorithm in this. We are going to learn based on the probability of actions happening, and that is what is reinforced learning. So this is a framework of reinforced learning. So this is a typical framework of a reinforcement learning scenario, where you have the agent, right, takes the action in an, so this is an environment which is interpreted by a reward and a representation of the state. So from the interpreter, it is either a reward or a state, or then you calculate the state of it, and which are fed back into the agent. So you understand that either you got a reward. Reward can be positive or negative both. So reward here means a reward and a, so reward here means an award or a penalty. So reward in this case is the action of plus and minus both. So this is the schematic diagram. So you have the agent, you have this environment, an action is done, and you get the reward or and the current state of it. So the state has changed now, and the agent is aware now what action has to be taken next. So the agent decides on the action based on the reward and penalty and changes the state to the next level. So in reinforcement learning, the agent observes a state and takes an action, and afterwards the agent receives an reward. So reward could be a penalty or a award as well. So what is this, these states in this Markovian decision process? So a state is a set of tokens that represent every state that the agent can be in, right? So state are those locations or actions or steps which the agent can be in. And what is this model we are talking about? The model, sometimes called the transition model, gives an action's effect in a state, in particularly T, which is a function of S, A, and S bar defines the transition T, where being a T, where being in a state S and taking an action A takes us to the state S dash, right? So it was in state S. After that transition has happened, it has now moved to S dash. In the next step, that S dash becomes S, and S double dash, which was the next step, would become S dash. So that is how the state has changed. So for stochastic actions, where noisy and non-deterministic, we also define the probability. So probability of next step S dash with respect to the current state and the action, which represent the probability of reaching the state S dash if action A is taken in the state S. So you are currently in state S and you have to take an action S, A. Now it will lead to S dash. So that, what is the probability of that happening, is the probability P. Note that Markov property states that the effect of an action taken in a state depends only on that state and not on the prior history. So it is history is gone, it is only the current state on which the agent is taking a decision. And what are these actions? So actions in this AI is a set of all possible actions, right? Move left, right, back, forward, all these are actions, right? If it is a robotic process. So A defines the set of actions that can be taken being in state S. So in if it is at the bottom of a grid, so you can only go left, right, or forward. You cannot go back because there is no back in this. So that is how the actions are defined at any state S. What is the reward then? The reward is the real valued reward function, so function R. And R is a function of S of a state, indicates the reward of simply being in the state S. The reward as a function of state and action indicates the reward of being in the state S and taking an action A. And reward of S, A and S dash indicates the reward of being in a state S, taken in an action A and ending up at a state S dash. So there are three rewards wherever you are, right? Wherever you are and you are taking an action. So that is another reward. And when you are at a particular state, you take an action and you reach another state S dash. So there is a different kind of a reward. So a reward could be a positive or a negative both, right? So it can be an award or a penalty, both cases. And what is this policy we are talking about? The policy is a solution to the Markovian decision process. So now this is the algorithm we are giving to the agent. So the policy is mapping from S to A. So from any state S, you are taking an action A. It indicates the action A to be taken while you are in state S. So that is the logic that you take up. So which is a Markovian decision process. And the mission is to optimize these rewards. So rewards are calculated in the environment. So every state and every action you have a reward. Used to teach the agent how to reach a particular goal state. Must signal when an ultimate want or a goal is achieved, not necessarily a sub goal. Maybe discounted over time. In general, seek to maximize the expected return. That is the mission of a Markovian reinforced learning. So decision network can be represented. So it can be an infinite steps as well, right? But let's talk about these in a finite step. So Markovian decision process is where you have a state, you have an action, and there is a reward. And accordingly, you reach another state. And then subsequently, you reach another state and further state. So finally, if you have to reach the final state, you understand what are the various rewards, positive or negative, based on the various actions and different states. So this is how a network representation can be done for the Markovian decision process. So what are the main points in reinforcement learning? So input is, it should be an initial state from which the model will start. So input, so start point. Output are many possible outputs as there are variety of solutions to a particular problem. So you can go via north, you can go via east, south, whatever, right? So ultimately there is a target, you have multiple solutions. Training is based upon the input, the model will return a state and the user will decide to reward or punish the model based on its output. So that is what is the training part. Now you are learning to collect more rewards. The model keeps continues to learn. So that's how you are training your dog. So that's what is the reinforcement learning. The best solution is decided based on the maximum. So whether this path was correct or the other path was correct, that is based on the maximizing the rewards. Let's take an example of a grid world, right? So let's assume a 4x3 great. And your starting point is 1, 1, right? And the destination is 4, 3. So an agent lives in the grid. The above example is a 3 by 4. So it's a 3 by 4 grid. The grid has a start grid number 1, 1. And the purpose of the agent is to wander around the grid to finally reach the blue diamond. So this diamond is a blue diamond. Grid number 4, 3. So 4, 3. So this one, it has to reach. So under all circumstances, the agent should avoid the fire grid. So this one, which is 4, 2, grid number 4, 2, right? And also the grid number 2, 2, which is this one, is a blocked grid. It cannot move to that grid. It acts as a wall. Hence, the agent cannot enter it. So this is a blocked grid. So if these conditions are given, right? So this is a playground. Now you have to start from 1, 1 and reach 4, 3, and then so every action and step has certain rewards and penalty. So let's say the grid, so the agent can take any of the following actions, right? Going up, down, left or right. And walls block the agent path. So these are the walls. If there is a wall in the direction of the agent, so if it has reached here 1, 3, so there is a wall. It would have taken the agent stays in the same place. So for example, if the agent stays left in the start, he would stay always at the start. So it has to take a different action. So it cannot always take left from 1, 1, right? So certain states, every state has a different action. So the aim is to find the shortest sequence getting from start to the diamond. Two such sequences can be found, right? So one is right, right, up, up and right. Another could be up, up, right, right, right. So these are two possible solutions to reach there that you know. But this, how does the system comes to know about it? So let us take the second one. Up, up, right, 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 the other one, this one, okay, for the discussion. So the movie is now noisy. So now we are adding the complexity part of it. 80% of the time, the intended action works correctly. 20% of the time, the action agent takes causes it move at the right angles. So it has only, it only knows right angles, right? Some right angles or forward or back. For example, if the agent says up, the probability of going up is 0.8, whereas the probability of going left is 0.1 and probability of going right is 0.1. So these are estimated values, since left and right is right angles to up, right? So accordingly, the probabilities are different. And the agent receives reward each time in each step. So a small reward in each step can be negative when we can be termed as punishment. So negative value can be termed as punishment. In the above example, entering a fire can have a reward of -1. So big rewards come at the end, so good or bad, right? And the goal is to maximize the sum of the rewards. That's the intent of the Markovian decision process. You have to maximize the sum of rewards. So there are various algorithms which are prevalent and active for control learning. So like the brute force, right, value function, Monte Carlo method, temporal difference method, or a direct policy search. I'll be talking about these in brief about it. So what is brute force method? So the brute force method approach entails two steps. One is for each possible policy, sample returns while following it. Second is to choose the policy when the largest expected returns are there. So brute force is based on a kind of action which is you are trying to force it. So one problem with this is that the number of policies can be large or even infinite. Another is that the variance of the returns may be large, which requires many samples to accurately estimate the return of each policy. These problems can be unsatisfactory if we assume some structure and allow samples generated from one policy to influence the estimates made from the other. So the two main approaches for achieving this are value function estimation and direct policy search. So brute force has two actions, value function estimation and direct policy search. So what is this value function? This approach is attempt to find a policy that maximizes the return by maintaining a set of estimates of expected returns of some policy, usually either of the current, so you are on policy, or the optimal, which is off policy. So these methods rely on the theory of the Markovian decision process, where optimality is defined in a sense that the stronger than the above one. So policy is called optimal if it achieves the best expected return from an initial state. From the initial state, it is to the target, it is the optimal and it is trying to maximize it. The initial distribution plays no role in the definition. Again, an optimal policy can always be found amongst stationary policies. Another was a Monte Carlo method. What is this Monte Carlo method? It can be used in an algorithm that mimics the policy iteration. So policy iteration consists of two steps, policy evaluation and policy improvement, right? So Monte Carlo is used in the policy evaluation step. In this step, given a stationary, right, you are at one point, deterministic policy pi, the goal is to compute the function value of q to the power pi as a function of state and action, or a good approximation method to them for all the states, state action pair, assuming the simplicity that Markovian decision process is finite. Let's assume it is a finite, that sufficient memory is available to accommodate the action values, and that the problem is episodic, and after each episode a new one starts from some random initial state. Then the estimate of the value of a given state action pair can be computed by averaging the sampled returns that originated from SA over time. So it is calculating the computing the average of the sampled returns from origin to current time. So it is taking the history part of it. Given sufficient time, this procedure can thus construct a precise estimate Q of the action values of Q to the power pi. In the policy improvement step, the next policy is obtained by computing a greedy policy with respect to Q. Given a particular state S, this new policy returns the action that maximizes the Q with a value of S and dot. In practice, lazy evaluation can defer the computation of maximizing the action so that those are needed. So what is this? What are the problems related to Monte Carlo method? So with this problem procedure, the problems are: the procedure may spend too much time evaluating a suboptimal policy, so it is calculating the history, calculating the mean, and then so it may take a lot of time. It uses samples inefficiently, in that a long trajectory improves the estimate only on the single state action pair that started the trajectory. So initially it will have a lesser value, but going forward, if it is an infinite set of phase, so it will become cumbersome, it becomes too expensive. So when the returns along the trajectory have high variance, the convergence is low. So ultimately you are leading to a confusion state. So it works in episodic problems only, and works in small finite MDPs, right? So that is what is the problem. If it is an infinite or bigger set of problem, the Monte Carlo problem, this is calculating the averages of the previous history, doesn't work well. We'll take an example. A lot of examples are there. This NASA space shuttle payload processing problem. We'll try to understand what is this NASA space shuttle payload processing problem. So scheduled tasks required for installation and testing. So before a shuttle or a space vehicle is launched, it has thousands and thousands of tasks to be done, right? So, and if there are multiple shuttle missions, so kind think of different tasks to be so many, right? So that is what is one of the problem that Scheduled tasks required for installation and testing of a shuttle cargo bay payload typically is 2 to 3 shuttle missions, each requiring 34 to 164 final stage tasks. So first successful instance of the reinforcement learning is applied in planning the stage. So state is the complete plans, and actions are plans are modified, right? So accordingly, the complexity changes. So states were an entire schedule. Complete schedule is the complete state. And two type of actions can be there. Reassign pool operators, which are reassigns a source to a different pool, and move operators. So move task to first earlier or later kind of a time with satisfied resource constraints. So a small negative reward for each step can be given. So like resource dilation factor, formula for rewarding final schedule's duration. So based on RDF formula, the final schedule of the launch is calculated. Another example is of this reinforcement learning is used in the data centers now. For data centers have multiple hundreds and thousands of servers, and based on their load balancers, these are so the MDP algorithm is there in the load balancer, which decides on the next request to be sent to different applications. Application one could be on a cluster of two servers, B on a cluster. So accordingly, load balancers also define the resource allocation. So if there are a cluster of servers, so some server or some application may need additional memory. So it dynamically changes the memory from less used application to the other one. So memory allocation and all happens using a very effective Markovian decision process algorithm, which is also used in the data centers. Various other uses of MDPs can be like robotic path planning, right? Travel route planning for a complex travel, or a elevator scheduling. You know, if two are at or multiple of them are at different levels, which one to come first is based on MDP. Bank customer retention logics. So these are all probabilistic based. Wherever there is a probabilistic based, MDP is best fit. Autonomous aircraft navigation, autonomous aircraft. So you have given the control to the aircraft for navigation, so it decides on and uses the Markovian decision process. Manufacturing process. Now a lot of manufacturing processes have started using the REIN. So in industry 4.0 is best fit for implementation of these AI tools. Now which understands this machine is performing at a optimum level, what is the production capacity it can go. So if the capacity is based on a more capacity, it can route the production to a different CNC machine, right? So that is how industry 4.0 is going to use reinforced learning and MDP for its optimized working. Network switching and routing, they effectively use. So one of the example was a load balancer, right? So in load balancer, similar to that, even the network switching and routing in these telephone exchanges, they use these reinforced learning algorithms. So now we come to the details of the MDP. So MDP, this Markovian decision process, also known as the dynamic programs or stochastic dynamic programs, sequential decision processes, or stochastic control problems. So people know them by different names. So another example is of checkers, right? Many of the people have played checkers. So the current state is your current configuration on the board. So your current state is at any point of time, it is the current configuration of various played states. Contains all information needed for transition to the next state. So your next action, all information is there. Thus, each configuration can be said to have a Markovian property. So checkers can also be treated as a use of MDP. So when we said there is a state, there is an action, there is an environment, there is a reward and award. So Google also uses this Markovian chain in their page ranking concept. So discrete time stochastic process with the Markovian property is used by the Google page rank algorithm. The probability distribution representing likelihood of random linking ending up on a page. So Google crawls all the pages and then tries to rank them based on this algorithm, Markovian chain, and then accordingly the search result will give it into page 1, page 2, or even search results are very far off. So you don't go to 10th search page, right? Your first page or second page or third page is good enough for you to find out your information. So how to increase, so these are part of your search engine optimization, SEO, SEM. People do a lot of research on Google's page rank algorithm and they try to identify what are those parameters which change the so people have identified lot of parameters which change the rank of a page. So certain keywords which are popular, they'll try to put those keywords into their pages, right? So what are those keywords which people are searching? So they continuously evaluate and improve the system for increasing their page rank as part of the search engine optimization techniques. Discrete time stochastic control process, extension of Markov chain, differences could be addition of action and addition of rewards. So those could be the difference. So if the actions are fixed, then Markovian decision process is reduced to a Markovian chain. So there is no probability part. If it is the actions are almost fixed, then it becomes a Markovian chain. So we are talking about the tuple combination of the state, the action, the probability, and the reward at each state, right? So this becomes a tuple. The tuple is a combination of the state in the space, in the environment, the action state, right? The action. Then you have the probability of moving from S to S dash, which is a combination of probability of the time in T plus 1, which is S dash, time at T, which is your current state, and the action at T, which is your action A, right? So probability is at a particular state S, which is you are in, at a S dash, which you are trying to achieve, with an action A. So that's the probability of doing that. And R at a particular state, current state, the reward at a state S. So this is the complete tuple that the MDP focuses on. And the goal is to maximize some cumulative function of these rewards. And finite MDPs have finite state and action spaces. But when it becomes a very infinite space and it is open ground, open action, so your actions and states and actions could be infinite, and hence it becomes a very complex process. Another example could be a recycling MDP robot. So it can search for trash can, wait for someone to bring a trash can, or go home and recharge the battery itself. It has two energy levels, high and low. So every robot will have identify itself. Searching runs down the battery, and waiting does not. And a depleted battery has a very low reward. So again, it understands every action as a reward and penalty, right? So depleted battery has a low reward. So it is a negative reward. So it immediately takes another action, which is recharging action. So when we talk about the stochastic processes, it's a random process and often viewed as a collection of index random variables useful to us. Why? Because set of states with probabilities of being in that state is indexed over time, and we'll deal with discrete stochastic processes. So it starts from x0 at any point t, and at that point t0 at time t move the step in z direction, where this is the function. At any point t the actions could be different, right? So these are various rewards based on different actions. So you can calculate the number of rewards and penalties it will have, a combination, and we are trying to the maximize this functions. So Markovian property also thought of as a memoryless property. So it's a memoryless property. A stochastic process is said to have the Markovian property if the probability of a state, which is n plus 1, having any given value depends only upon the current state. That is the stochastic process, very much dependent on the description of these states. The basic model ingredients are the decision epochs, right? So what are these decision epochs? The points at which a decision is taken. So if I have to take a decision every 5 minutes, so right, so that is a decision epoch. The state space S, the action A at an state S, rewards as a function of time at any state and action, and the transition probabilities, right? So this model is called stationary if rewards and transition probabilities are independent of t. With independent of t, then these are stationary models. So we have seen that from one state decision epoch to another decision epoch t to t plus 1, the action and the state has changed. So some variants on the basic model are, there may be a continuous of state and action, decisions may be made in continuous time, rewards and transition rates may change over time, and system state may not be observable. Some model parameters may not be known. So then you can define your derived quantities. So decision rules T, the policies and strategies and plans can be defined, and the stochastic processes, which is more of a probabilistic model, can be defined with value functions. So value functions differ from immediate rewards. They represent the value starting in a state of all future events also. The objective is to identify a policy that maximizes either the expected total reward, which is finite or infinite in the horizon, expected discounted reward, expected long run average reward, or expected utility. So multiple optimization or maximizations can be done, possibly subject to constraints on a system performance. So there are different equations which can be computed. So Markovian decision process computation and theory focuses on solving the optimality, which is a Bellman equation. So these are some complex structures to learn. This can be expressed as a function of the MDP process. So optimality, somewhere we have to optimize the function, which is called the Bellman equation. So there are certain theoretical issues also. When does an optimal policy with nice structure exist? Does it really exist? So Markov or stationary policy, which is better? Control limit policy. When do the computational algorithm converge and how fast? So are these algorithms converging to some point? What properties do solutions of the optimality equation have? So these are some theoretical issues which the research people have to come out with. So calculating the optimal policies, why? For implementation purpose. For gold standard of heuristics. What is this gold standard of heuristics? So 10 usability heuristics for users interface design, which was developed by Jacob Nielsen and Rolf Mollisch in 1990. So it is used in the user UI design. So 10 usability heuristics for UI design, which are called the gold standard for heuristics. Or the basic principle is to transform multi-period problem into a sequence of one period problem. Why is computation difficult in practice? Because of dimensionality, the curse of dimension. So multiple factors affect it. So somewhere you have to reduce those dimensions, the curse of dimensionality. Computational methods could be finite horizon model, which is a backward induction or a dynamic programming model. Infinite horizon model, so finite horizon and infinite horizon, right? So in finite, we can use dynamic programming backward induction. In infinite horizon, value iteration or policy iteration, it will work on under a policy, modified policy iteration, linear programming, or even neurodynamic programming, which is a reinforcement learning. So complex algorithms can be used for infinite horizon computing. So iterative algorithms work as follows, right? Approximate the value function by VS and select a new decision rule by maximizing the value average of these. So reapproximate the value function by approximation methods, exact for policy iteration, iterative for value iteration and modified policy iteration, and simulation based is for the reinforcement learning. So we have seen that Markovian decision process is a discrete time stochastic control process. In a discrete time stochastic probability based control process, at each time step the process is in some state S, and the decision maker, the agent, may choose any action A which is available in that state S. The process responds to the next step, next time the step, by randomly moving into a new state S dash and giving the decision maker a corresponding reward R with a state of current state S and S dash with an action A, right? So this is what is the summary of a decision Markovian process. So an MDP consists of a set of X states, let's say. So this set of start state S, and it's a subset of the complete S. Any action could be a subset of a total set of states X, right? A set of action A, a reinforcement function R. So R is a function of X, and an action A is the expected immediate reinforcement for taking a action A in the state X. And an action model, which is more of a probability, where X, it is moving to X dash with X and action A, giving the probability that executing action A in the state X will lead to the state X dash. So MDP as a process consists of these four components, SART. What is S? It's a finite, in the finite state, it is a state S. In the finite state, it is an action A. R is for the reward function, real valued reward function. So immediate reward we get to for being in a state S. For example, in a goal-based domain, R may equal 1 for goal state and 0 for all others, right? So that can be a target, for an example, can be generalized to include the action cost, which is a reward at a particular state R S with an action A. It can be generalized to a stochastic function also. Then you have the T, which is a transition function, which is the probability function. So the probability of going to state S dash after taking an action A in state S. So how many parameters does it take to represent all these SART? It can easily generate to countable and continuous state and action spaces, but algorithm will be different for each problem statement. So this is the graphical view of the MDP. So every state has reward and actions, right? Moves to, at any point of time t, moves to t plus 1, with action and a reward. So it moves to another action. So important point is, it is a requirement that the choice of action should be dependent solely on the current state of observation X. So this is required, right? Should not depend on the history or any other independent actions. So it is purely dependent on the current state. If knowledge of prior action or states affect the current choice of action, then the decision process is not Markovian. So if the knowledge of prior action or state affects the current choice, so this agent, if it takes the decision based on the previous knowledge history and previous states, then it is not a Markovian decision process. So Markovian decision process is primarily when it is only solely dependent on the current state and the actions. So what is the difference between Markovian decision process and Markovian chain? So Markovian decision process are an extension of Markovian chain. However, the difference is the addition of actions allowing the choice. And so when the action becomes predictable or specific, then it is a Markovian chain. You know what is the next step, right? And rewards giving motivation. So in Markovian MDP, there is a reward and you know that there is a probability of the action happening and there is no set defined action. So this is the difference between Markovian chain and the MDP. Conversely, if only one action exists for each state, so if one action is available and all rewards are zero, so the Markovian decision process is reduced to a Markovian chain, right? So this is what we discussed. So Markovian chain, only one set of actions are there and there is no reward policy. So whenever there is a multiple actions based on your probability and your decision making power, and there is a reward or penalty, then it is a Markovian decision process. And when it is a no action, a specific action and no reward, it becomes a Markovian chain. So underlying, there are some principles. The principle one is, if the action causes something bad to happen immediately, such as crashing the plane, let's say, then the system learns not to do that action in that situation again. So that's one of the principles. So if an action causes something bad to happen immediately, then it learns not to do that action in the next step. So whatever action the system performs 1 millisecond before the crash, it will avoid during doing it in the future also. So it has learned, if the same system can be made to learn, it has learned from that action and it will avoid that crash. But that principle doesn't help for all the earlier actions which doesn't lead to immediate disaster, right? So that disasters happen because of certain earlier actions, so it doesn't really help. Disasters happen. Another principle is, if all the actions in a certain situation leads to a bad result, then that situation should be avoided. So previous was a action which is something bad to happen, so results are bad, so immediately it will learn that it will not do that action. But if that action leads to a bad result, so bad result in this case would be reward and penalty. So if penalty is given, then that situation should be avoided. It will learn that it should avoid the penalty scenario. So if the system has experienced a certain combination of altitude and airspeed many different times, thereby trying a different action each time, so all actions lead to something bad, then it will learn that the situation itself is bad, right? Because that situation has come, so it understands that the situation is bad. It has learned from the previous combination of altitude and airspeed. So powerful principle. So this is a power is a powerful principle, because learning system can now learn without crashing. So in the future, anytime it chooses an action that leads to its particular situation, it will immediately learn that particular action is bad, without having to wait for the crash. So it has learned from the previous one. Now it understands that that action will lead to a crash and it will not do that action. So some more examples of MDP could be, machines can be in one of the three states, let's assume good, deteriorating or broken. So it can take two actions, maintenance or ignore that action, ignore no action to be done. So this can be represented in this kind of a good shape, right? Deteriorating or broken. So broken, it cannot be ignored, it has to be maintained. Deteriorating, to some extent it can be ignored, but maintenance has to be done. In good shape, maintenance not required and can be, it can continue to run. So that way the MDP can be represented in a graphical output with all states of state, action, reward, penalty. So with respect to the previous one, the policies could be, no time period is different from the other, and optimal thing to do in state S should not depend on time period. So in this case, it is not dependent on the time period because of infinite horizon. With finite horizon, doesn't want to maintain the machine in the last period, and a policy of is a function of pi with state to action. Example policy, good shape, ignore, right? Pi function of deteriorating, it can be ignored, or it can also go into maintenance in certain conditions. And in broken state, it has to go to maintain mode, right? So it doesn't depend on time, it is dependent on that state. When we evaluate a policy, key observations is MDP plus policy is equal to the Markovian process with rewards. So you have to define a policy. Reward and penalty is a policy. Already know how to evaluate Markovian process with rewards, system of linear equations. Gives algorithm for finding optimal policy. Try every possible policy and then evaluate in efficient. The two principles, by using these two principles, a learning system can learn to fly a plane, control a robot, or do any number of tasks. So system has to maintain and follow those two principles. It can first learn on a simulator and then fine-tune on the actual system. So these systems are made to learn on a simulator, and while on actual run, it does fine-tune those learnings. So this technique is generally referred to as the dynamic programming we are talking about. So many more examples can be, we have already seen airline meal planning, behavioral ecology, or capacity expansion. These all can be the Markovian decision process, or decision analysis, equipment replacement, at what time it has to be replaced, right? Fisheries management, gambling systems use Markovian decision process, highway pavement repair, at what particular time it has to be repaired, under what wear and tear, under certain condition. Inventory control has to be very probabilistic and a state based. Job seeking strategies, at what time you need to change. So it's all based on the current state, the action, and the probability of you getting success from there, right? Snapshot problems, learning, medical treatment, network control, they all use the Markovian decision process. Other could be option pricing. Project selection could be a probabilistic model. Queuing system control, robotic movement, scheduling. So as I said, data centers are very effective. Some of the great data centers, good data centers, they have started using the Markovian decision process to lot of analytical tools are being used for maintaining these servers, right? Like servers generate a lot of logs, right? So every server would generate 100 MBs of log. Every second, there is a multiple factors and they are being logged into a log. But then the tools have come which analyzes these server logs and tries to find, calculates the pattern of various failures. So if a particular error has happened or a warning is there on a hard disk, so it now understands that the hard disk is going bad in certain time. What is that time period? It has calculated from the previous data. So now it will start warning to the system that the hard disk may fail in 3 days time, right? So accordingly, the preventive maintenance guy can shut down, ask for a shutdown, and then replace the hard disk. So accordingly, these data centers have started using the stochastic probability models, and these Markovian decision problems can be used very effectively in the data centers. User modeling, vision, computer face identification, and all, water resources, right? X-ray dosage, yield management, zebra hunting. So these are some of the other applications which MDP uses. So decision epochs, I said, these are the sequences of time at which the decision maker is required to take a decision, take an action. So at what point he has to take an action? Does he need to take an action after every step, or after certain steps where some values are going beyond certain thresholds? If that rewards are going beyond certain threshold, it has to take an action. So it doesn't take an action every step. Right. So these are decision epochs. So at maybe at departure time, or 1 to 3 hours, so pre-departure, 4 to 6 hours pre-departure, or 5 to 36 hours. So those are the times at which the decisions can be taken. So decisions can be taken at these 4 points. So from 36 hours to 5 hours, one action decision can be taken. From 6 to 4, one decision can be taken about the inventory of the food. Or from 1 to 3 hours, last minute, few hours before the departure, action can be taken. Or just at the right time of the departure time. That is actual, so it has to take a call immediately. So those are the decision points. States are zero, lying between 0, 1 and the limit, the capacity, multiple states. And actions are like meal quantity after delivery. So at different states, the meal quantity would be calculated. These are the actions. And the cost is a combination of multiple things, like meal cost, the return penalty, right? So if it is delayed, late delivery charges, shortage costs, airlines charge you for the shortage cost. If 100 a particular were required and you are delivering 90 of them because your delivery van only had 90 at that point of time, so you would be charged for the shortage also. So it is the total, this is the reward, right? So the reward is a combination of all these. The meal cost, the return penalty. So some costs, some penalties make it a complete value. Even so, meal quantity can be taken a call 18 hours scheduled production. So it takes certain production time also. So it has to calculate the production time and the delivery. 6 hours order the assembly time, 3 hours order ready to go, right? And adjust with the van at the time of departure. So lot of action is required in these. So these are the two graphs where no Markovian decision program are done. So which is the actual, this is the actual one. So it is the standard deviation is high, right? And the mean is high because the distribution of frequency, the errors are high. But when we use a model of MDP model, so the provisioning errors get reduced, the mean has reduced, and the standard deviation, and the errors are predictable. So accordingly, if you start using the Markovian decision processes, it actually improves your the probability model and improves your efficiency, and the rewards are increased. Overage versus shortage. So evaluating the model over a range of terminal costs observes the relationship of a average overage and proportion of flights short catered. So let's say 55 flight numbers, the aircraft capacity combination, if all these are calculated, the kind of complexity increases. So another concept is information acquisition. Information acquisition. So information acquisition, the objective is investigate the trade-off between acquiring information and the optimal policy choice. At any point of time, do you really need more information, or you can manage optimally manage with the current choices? Examples are many. So, like in 1982, the study output decision of a competitive firm in a market with random demand, in which the demand distribution is unknown. That was a model. Even in 94, the study dynamic pricing decisions of a firm in a market which unknown consumer demanded with a demand curve. I'll give you an example of this dynamic pricing. I was working on a e-commerce. We had developed a e-commerce portal for the travel industry, and travel agents primarily were booking through that B2B travel in this travel portal. So we were doing some lot of analytical. We were running our analytical tools, and on the data we were able to see that every Tuesdays, right? Every Tuesdays there was a surge in some surge in the sales. So we evaluated over time. So we have seen that every Tuesday, more most Tuesdays, the number of sales were high. So then we got worried why that sale on Tuesdays are high. So when we came to know that most likely those people who dis or a couple would have decided on Sunday to go for a travel, right? To book for a travel, air travel. But on Monday, the guy would have forgotten. So finally, on Tuesdays, ladies were doing those transactions on Tuesday morning or Tuesday first half. So that travel booking was done, most of them was done by the ladies, and that too on Tuesdays. So what we did, we started the dynamic pricing concept. So every Tuesdays, we said that, okay, if you are doing a transaction within next 1 2 hours or so, you will get a discount coupon of 100 rupees or something, right? So, and what is that value is calculated based on the total deals we were giving. So this dynamic pricing we were giving on Tuesdays on first half, and then if you so that cal w was calculated based on certain algorithm, and we've seen that after a month or so, our sales almost doubled because of this. Every Tuesdays, because of dynamic deal pricing, and we started this dynamic deal pricing very frequently after that, because it gave us a return, and our sales increased almost to the double the size. So those are practical examples which I can I'm able to share about this dynamic pricing. Even in 99 and all these times, study order decision of a censored news vendor with unobservable lost sales and unknown demand distribution. So the key result is it is optimal to experiment. So we did an experiment and we were successful, and finally we made it a policy to give, start giving the dynamic deal pricing to our customers. So what are these partially observed Markovitch decision processes? So in this partially observed MDPs, the system state is not observable. That means the decision maker receives a signal Y, which is related to the system state by a state Q at any state Y with a state S and A. So it is not a state, but a signal, right? It's a partially observed. So analysis is based on using Bayes' theorem to estimate the distribution of a system state given the signal. So based on the Bayes' probabilistic theorem, it estimates a signal value, which is not actually a state of that at that point of time. Similar to Bayesian MDPs describe, so the posterior state distribution is a sufficient static for statistics for decision making. State space is a continuum, and early work has been done as early as 1970. So the applications of partially observed MDPs are the medical diagnostics and treatment, and the equipment repair. So even recently, the COVID vaccination, right? It has been done in a year's time. Earlier, it would take 4 years' time, 3 years' time to come out with a vaccination. But how was it possible? It is all possible because of these probabilistic models, the use of AI, the use of machine learning. Based on all that, it was able to simulate the kind of, based on the data, it was able to simulate on different type of human beings, different age groups, male and female. So different, it was able to simulate all this data based on the current data of certain stage one, stage two, and finally stage three was more realistic. So these stages, stage one, some data was there. It was able to extrapolate based on the maybe Markovian decision process or some AI tools, and it was able to estimate it, the impact of that vaccine on other different categories of human being. And finally, with the stage three, it was almost accurate, and it was released now for our vaccination process. So another concept is neurodynamic programming in the reinforcement learning. So neurodynamic programming, or it is also reinforcement learning, but a different way to think about dynamic programming is a basis of in artificial intelligence research, and it mimics a learning behavior of animals. It is developed to solve problems with high dimensional state space and solve the problem in which the system is described by a simulator, as opposed to a mathematical model in the previous discussions. So neurodynamic is more a simulator based. Neurodynamic programming is a collection of methods combining the Monte Carlo method. So Monte Carlo, we have seen that it was more based on the kind of model MDP was using, and so it's a combination of Monte Carlo method with MDP concept. So it's a trade-off. So mimics learning by experimenting in real life, learn by interacting with the environment. Goal is a long term, uncertainty may be present, and trade-off between exploration and exploitation. So it has to do a balance between exploration. Exploring means going to the next step, and exploitation is your reward. So it has to do a trade-off between. So it is a open space, and that is how simulators are used to do a neurodynamic programming. So key focus is estimating the value function. Start with a guess of value function, and then carry out tasks and observe the immediate outcomes. So reward and transition, right? And update the value function. So it keeps updating the value functions, and it starts with the guess function. Fine. So that is what is the neurodynamic programming. Example could be playing a tic-tac-toe. So you know the rules of the game, right? But not the opponent's strategy. You know the rules, others' strategy you do not know. Assume fixed over time, but with random component. Approach is to list possible system states and start with initial guess of probability. So you start with certain one position of probability of winning in each state. Observe the current state and choose the action that will move you to the state with the highest probability of winning. And observe state after. So observe state is S dash after the opponent's play. So opponent has played, that is the S dash in this case. Next step. Now you have to take another call. Revise values in state S based on the value S dash. So it has moved one step, the opponent. Now that is the current state. Now you have to take a call. So based on the current state after the opponent has made a call, then that is state becomes S. Now you have to take another decision based action based on the all possible values. So player might not always choose the best action, but try other actions to learn from the different states. So dimension of this state space is 3 to the power 9, right? And the writing down the mathematical model of the game is challenging and simulating it is easy. Mathematically, it cannot be done, but simulating on a computer using these methods is easy. Goal is to maximize the probability of winning. There is no immediate reward, right? So every step is a, you have to take a call after the opponent has already run into an action. Then you have to take a call again for the benefit of it. The subsequent states S dash depend on the player, other player's action. So reinforcement learning problems can be classified in these two ways, terminating and non-terminating. So the model would be estimate V by simulating in the terminating the process many times to termination. Use estimate with model to choose a policy or improvement. If you're not using the model, the estimate Q by simulating the process many times to termination. Use the estimate of Q to choose the policy or improvement. In non-terminating, the estimate V by using temporal difference updating. Use estimate with model to choose the policy or improvement. And with no model, it is estimate by using the temporal function updating. Use the estimate of Q to choose the policy of improvement. Another example could be of this image with backgammon. So this is a game wherein two players, it's a very popular game. So there also this reinforcement learning can be used. Checkers, right? Player robotic control, elevator dispatching based on a decision, dynamic telecommunication channel allocation, again is a based on the probabilistic model, which channels are. So many a times you would have seen that when you are connecting, so if you have connected once, your connections go through very easily in the next step, because the system understands that this particular channel is continuously used, so the usage probability goes high. And so many a times you would have seen that a particular connection doesn't work, so it routes to multiple channels, and then when you disconnect and try again, now it has learned that there is a channel which it has to go through. Now that path would be faster and the final connection could be established, so then it will try to optimize that which is the shortest path. And when you frequently call a person, that the channel, telecommunication channel, is saved into the memory of that system based on the probability and the state and the reward. So that is what is this is dynamic telecommunication channel allocation. So shop floor scheduling, job of shop floor scheduling based on different capacities of CNCs and robots, and based on the downtime, preventive maintenance and all that, it does a rescheduling, which is the MRP2 kind of a scheduling, which can use the probabilistic and the reinforcement learning. Supply chain optimization, lot of reinforcement learning or machine learning can be used in supply chain management. From the start of manufacturing to the delivery till, so where all the warehouses could be, wherever the customers are more, are they clustered around that? What is the distance between a warehouse to the shop? How much is the distance? If a new product, what is the inventory of those products, right? So in a supply chain management, whether cold storages are nearby where it is urgently required. So you have to plan so accordingly that the costs have to be optimized. And for supply chain management, a lot of tools have come which uses the machine learning and artificial intelligence based applications. And with COVID, a lot of supply chain optimization has to happen, because earlier India was using a lot of raw material from different countries. Now everything was stopped, so now it has to build in that area. So the supply chain has to happen, and supply chain optimization has to happen. Now the cost would have been different, now the cost would be different. So even after COVID, if the production is localized, so maybe the cost will come down drastically. So that is one of the good effects of COVID, that the supply chain has become very optimized, and people have started talking about the optimization of the supply chain engine. So just to sum up this neurodynamic programming, it is unclear which algorithm and parameters setting will work on a particular problem. And when a method does work, it is still unclear which ingredients are actually necessary for the success. Multiple factors have made it a success, but we do not know which has made it a success. So as a result, applications often require trial and error in a long process of parameter tweaking and experimentation. So that was stated by Van Roy in 2002. So finally, some towards the concluding remarks. So MDP, the Markovian decision process, provides an elegant formal framework for the sequential decision making, and they are widely applicable. They can be used to compute the optimal policy. Calculating the policy here means the reward and penalty. They can be used to baseline to evaluate the heuristics, the probabilistic part of it, and they can be used to determine the structural result about the optimal policies. So recent research is addressing the curse of, so we talked about the curse of dimensionality. I've seen certain research going on in this field. So recent people are working on reducing the dimensions. So some general descriptions are: the agent interacting with the environment. The agents can be in many states. Agent can take many actions, right? Agents get reward from the environment, and agents want to maximize the sum of future rewards. Environment can be stochastic. Examples could be cleaning robot in an office space. So the space is predefined and it understands the total space where it has to perform. Person planning a career move. So it understands. So this could be an example of a probabilistic stochastic process. Google page ranking again is a very people have been studying the Google page ranking concept. So this agent, which is a user browsing page and follows the links from page to page. So which page has led to that page, right? Backlink, forward link. So it understands and calculates the page ranking algorithm. So we want to predict the probability that the user will visit each page. And states are the n pages that the user can visit, A, B, C, D, right? So the action is following a link. Probability is a function of point P to point P dash, and special case is no rewards are defined in this case, right? But still, it's a very complex, the Google page ranking concept is ever changing process, and people keep following the Google page ranking concept with trial and error. If we change certain parameters, what is the effect of the page ranking? So they continuously test one of the sites. So they create one site and try to rank them as per the changing the various parameters. So these search engine optimization companies, what they do, they continuously do a hit and trial with these algorithms and evaluate and formulate a process of the search engine optimization. The rewards in all of the following: assume a learning agent taking an action. What would be the reward in a game where agent competes versus an opponent? So action is capture location B. Answer could be, so which could be a reward for an agent that is trying to find routes between various locations. So choose a route D could be a result on an action. So what is the reward for a person planning for a career move? So it is the right time to change a job. So those kind of actions could be your reward points. So we have seen that objective of MDP is to maximize the returns. To maximize the returns, sum of R of future rewards. So R is the sum of R1, R2, R3. And the problem with this objective is R will diverge. Solution is use discount parameter concept. So people have started using the discount parameter. So you can define by using R is sum of R1 plus a discount parameter of R2 plus discount parameter square, so sigma square or rho square and R3. So R converges if rewards have upper bound, and R is called the return. Monetary reward and inflations are an example of the maximizing the returns. So MDP problem, we have already seen that the given state, action and reward, the model of the environment is the transition probabilities and the reward functions to obtain the policy of that the sigma is allowed and return R is maximized. So that's the summary of the Markovian decision process. In chess, we have seen that the current configuration of the board, that is the current state, it contains all information needed to transition to the next state, and thus each configuration can be said to have a Markovian property. Each configuration, any combination can lead to a Markovian. So at any point of time in a chess, you can run the Markovian decision process. So Deep Blue was primarily using Markovian decision process to run against Garry Kasparov. So reinforcement learning, the motivation is like MDPs, but this time we don't know the model that is following is unknown. Transition probabilities are unknown, reward functions are unknown, right? Rewards. So if such is the case, there are certain games also running on Markovian decision process. UT domination game, so there's a game. So a number of fixed domination locations are there, and ownership is the team of last player to step into the location. Scoring is done based on the step. A team point be awarded for every 5 second location remains controlled, and winning the first team to reach a predetermined score, let's say 50. So these kind of games which are probabilistic and Markovian in nature are also available. So in reinforcement learning, agents learn policies through reward and punishment. Policy is determines what action to take from a given particular state, and agent's goal is to maximize these returns. So tabular technique, we maintain the queue state, and so if you see that queue table is primarily a tabular, so every state there are multiple options, and from every option you will end up with hundreds of other options. So it's a very complex evaluation process. So people have also started using this retaliate method. So retaliate is an adaptive game AI, right? So in reinforced tactic learning in agent team environment. So retaliate is an algorithm which is used by these adaptive game AIs, where it has a game bot. Bot is a agent which is running. It controls two or more UT bots, and the commands bots to execute action through the game bot API, right? So the UT server provides the sensory state or event information about the UT world and controls all game plays. And the game bot acts as a middleware between the UT server and the game AI. And the various components are the retaliate model algorithm, plugin bot, which can be different environment related, and this game bot API. Through this game bot API, players are playing. So state information and action, lot of information would be there. The movement of gun, right? The number of pellets in it, right? Time, different the other parameters, right? So what is the other gun type? So accordingly, based on all these information, the bot API calculates the next step, right? So ownership, and then it takes the next step, run to or stop or jump, whatever action has to be taken is based on the retaliate algorithm. So what is this algorithm? So to restore the state table and initial state, when you begin the game, you choose the probabilities. So probability epsilon, it's a random applicable action, and the probability of 1 minus epsilon, which is the applicable action with maximum value in the state action. And based on those two, you take a execute an action. You observe the current state and then calculate the reward and update the state action table. So it calculates whether the game is over or not. So if the game is over, you are done. If no, then you choose from the next probability level. So it is an iterative process. Every step it is calculating the probability and the probability of not happening, and accordingly the next steps. So these are different bots that are prevalent in the industry, right? STN bot, opportunistic bot, possessive bot, greedy bot, and the retaliate model, which is in the reinforcement learning. And different models have over time, retaliate was the optimum score. Retaliate made the optimum score over the other opponents. So within the first half of the first game, retaliate developed a competitive strategy, and against the opportunistic, possessive, and greedy control strategies, retaliate won all three games in the tournament. So this so it has compared with other. So if we see this STN bot versus retaliate, the difference is less, right? In the round two, the retaliate has moved up and the differences become high. So initially it calculates the strategy in the first half or something time, and then second half it takes the correct move. So discussions are over. The way to get started is to quit talking and